the Abdullah bin Khalifa Stadium in Doha. A reminder of the past in a land that looks to the future. The canvas design of this remarkable stadium that trims the pitch as you glance skywards into the nights and the heavens of Doha. You are reminded of the Bedouin tents, the Bayt al-Shah, that used to dot the landscape of what is now full of skyscrapers that look upwards. The Bedouin were travellers, but they were more than that. They were poets, they were scholars. They were people that told tales, because to tell stories was to never forget where you'd come from. They kept their culture, their civilization alive in oral tradition, in the Tagruda and the Nabati, tales of heroes. Well, if you look backwards, it's kind for Iran, because in this particular fixture against Syria, they have only lost once. So for Iran, they have plenty of tales of heroes of days gone by in the AFC Asian Cup. Qatar 2023, they will feel confident indeed. For Syria, the past perhaps is a thing to look at with caution, to not spend too much time dwelling on what was once the case, but maybe remember in their own epic poem a man called Abdulghani Tatish, who scored when they beat Iran for the only time in 1973. But the future is theirs. The Cassian Eagles have done something which no one before in their nation did, to make it through to the knockout stage of the AFC Asian Cup. Now, in this reminder of the Bedouin culture of Qatar, the architects of the epic poems of this region, it's time for Syria to write the next verse. The question is whether they can do it.
It's a nervous wait in the tunnel for Syria. If they are going to rewrite history, Oli, then they're going to do it under the guidance of Hector Cooper, and he has rewritten the script for Syria. As you said, they have got themselves to the knockout stage for the very first time. He's also got a brand new crop of players he's searched far and wide for to bring back and make them a team incredibly difficult to break down and to beat. So he's forgetting the history. He's not looking at the past, despite his age, despite many people thinking he might be the man who's just here for a paycheck. He's not. He's rewritten how Syria are playing the game. It's not pretty, but it's so far been very, very effective. And I think what's going to happen today is Iran, for all of their successes, 16 games unbeaten since the World Cup, 16 games in which they have beaten many, many good teams. They're going to have to work so, so hard to break down the house that Hector is building.
The AFC Asian Cup, Qatar 2023, Iran versus Syria in the round of 16 at the Abdullah bin Khalifa Stadium, a stadium designed to honour the architecture of the Bedouin, the original inhabitants of this part of the world, who still number 50,000 in Qatar. The Bedouin were nomads, and these teams understand that their journey could well come to an end. This is knockout football. It's time to focus on the future, to ignore the past, to write your place in the history of the AFC Asian Cup. Which of these nations will pack their bags and leave this tent behind and head to the quarterfinal for the next stage of their journey?
Thank you. السماء بعالي السماء
of the Islamic Republic of Iran and Syria, respectively, in this round of 16 meeting at the Abdullah bin Khalifa Stadium in Doha.
It's a noisy little atmosphere.
Amir Khalinoy is yet to lose a match in charge of the Islamic Republic of Iran, and goalkeeper Alireza Behrenvand is a huge part of that today. It's his 67th cap for Team Melli. The captain is number 3 left-back Ehsan Hajisafi, who is appearing at this competition for the fourth consecutive time. The central midfield contains two extremely experienced players who are great at supporting the defence and allowing the forwards freedom to have fun. And fun they have. Number 18 Mehdi Gayedi scored against Palestine and also against Hong Kong, China. And number 20 Sada Azmoun leads the line and has an incredible record of 50 goals in 75 matches for Iran. What a run they've been on. Absolutely phenomenal form. 16 matches unbeaten, the Islamic Republic of Iran. And they have only lost one out of 31 against Syria, today's opponents. It is an unenviable task that faces their opponents, the Kassion Eagles. And this nation also three times champions, the last in 1976. For many people, they are very serious contenders to win this tournament, and it's easy to see why. Kim Jong-hyuk, 40 years old, is the referee. His second match here, he started refereeing in the top flight of football in the Republic of Korea in 2009, and he's also refereed four AFC Champions League matches this season. And it will be his colleague Kim Hee-gon, who is the head referee in the VAR room. Veteran Hector Cooper has achieved legendary status in Syria after guiding the Kassion Eagles to the knockout stage. 34-year-old Ahmed Medania is his preferred goalkeeper. Number 24, Abdulrahman Awais, plays at right back and is an incredibly hard-working defender. In midfield, number 12, Amar Ramadan, is one to watch, a skilled and creative player whose father, Munaf, played at the 1988 AFC Asian Cup here in Qatar. And number 7, Omar Khabin, starts up front today. He scored Syria's only goal of the tournament so far in their defeat of India. It's a lovely stadium, this, isn't it? An intimate venue, beautifully designed, and the sparkling night sky of Doha is our reward as we look out over it.
Very much looking forward to this one. It is how the Argentine connection of Hisar, Halil Elias and Alam can cope with Taremi and Azmoun that could decide this.
The very warmest of welcomes to you indeed. It's a great pleasure to have your company for the round of 16 at the AFC Asian Cup Qatar 2023. Iran facing Syria, Iran playing in the white kit and playing a fixture that they've only lost once in the previous 30 meetings. It is an incredible record that they have, and they also are unbeaten in 16 matches against all opposition. Des Corkill sits alongside me. Des, you've been a scholar of the game in Asia for a very, very long time, and you have seen this Iranian team beat all comers of late.
I've also seen them go through some struggles as well. What happened in the World Cup in Qatar just 15 months ago when they imploded with political infighting, literal political infighting. That is not the Iran that I have seen. I have seen an Iran that can produce players who can play in the best leagues. You look at Azmoun in Italy, Taremi at Porto, Jahanbakhsh at Feyenoord. They are a very, very good side. But the Argentine connection in the heart of the midfield of Halil Elias and Ezequiel Alham. I say the Argentine connection because they play their football in the rough, tough Argentine Primera Division. They could be a stumbling block for Iran. Fascinating to see how Iran cope with that.
Well, in this stadium, whose canvas backdrop that lines the stands, the very full stands with noisy spectators in them, it is a tribute to Bedouin architecture. And it is very fitting, perhaps, that Hector Couper has nomadically roamed the globe to find much of the Syrian diaspora and bring them and make them part of the Argentinian connection, as you say, that is now at the heart of this Syrian national team. And they really are a great bunch of players.
Yeah, he's meshed them together very well. They know their limitations. They tried to get up in support of the front two. Herban is important. Down the right-hand side, Alassouadi. He's one of only four players who play their football in Syria. And he's got to play both ways, back and forward.
We just saw there, moving forward, wearing number 18, Mehdi Gayedi. He is a gentleman who can cause enormous problems creatively. Here is Taremi, moves the ball onto Jahanbakhsh. An opportunity for Iran to create, but it's cut out well. It's going to be fiercely hard work, this, for the Syrian team. In charge of the Iranian team, Amir Khalenoi, 60-year-old, he took over last year, and yet to lose a match.
It's his second spell in charge as well, and he's really calmed the ship. He wasn't a serial winner when he was in Iranian football, but he's always been competitive. But what he's done is just meshed this team together. He's got an Iranian league-based defence, or a Persian Gulf Pro League-based defence, an attacking flair from all over Europe and the United Arab Emirates. He's done a great job in meshing this team together.
Strong challenge, as you would expect, from Abdulrahman Owais.
I like that from Kim. There's not a touch, she's not bought it. And indeed, there was a flying foot from Hayadi.
Hector Couper, 68, from Argentina, his fifth international job. And this is his 14th match in charge of the Casion Eagles. I'm sure many of you remember back in the day he led Valencia to two UEFA Champions League finals. And his opposite number, Amir Khalenoi, actually won the Asian Club Championship, the precursor of the AFC Champions League, as a player with Esteghlal in 1991. And he's got a connection as well, Amir Khalenoi, to Qatar. He played for Al Sadd in the 1980s.
But he is steeped in Iranian football. He's not a big name outside of the region. Even outside of Iran, he's not the hugest of name, but he's just steadied the ship, and it's so good. There's no talk of any disruption of any kind from the Iranian camp. They've come on, they've got on with the job, 4-1 over Palestine, beating Hong Kong, oh, that was tough, and then beating UAE as well. Could have been more than the 2-1 it eventually was. Rock steady job, 16 games unbeaten in international football.
Number six is Saeed Ezatollahi, who plays for Velia in Denmark. Now an opportunity for Azmoun to potentially play in Taremi. He didn't last too long, and that's what Syria have been brilliant at, isn't it, Des, throughout this competition, is tough, efficient defending.
If Iran do try to go through the middle, they're just going to come up against a red brick wall. Because in front of the back two, Krumah and Usop, They've got Halil Elias and Ezekiel Alam, who are tigerish in their tackling.
Saman Hodous wears number 14 for the Islamic Republic of Iran, plays for Brentford. Was born in Malmö in Sweden, but his parents from the west of Iran.
Yes, it's not only Syria that has the diaspora. Lovely tight intimate stadium here, and it's giving us a good atmosphere. It's one of the, it is the smaller stadium being used for the AFC Asian Cup.
And we'll bid farewell to it after this match, because it's the last time it will be used in the competition. This is possibly going to be offside. It looks like it's on, in fact. No, now the flag has gone up. Sardar Azmoun was marginally ahead of the line.
It's beautifully created, though. It started with Siri giving the ball away, and Hector Cooper was furious with Ezekiel Alam for trying an ambitious ball. It's a decent save, not the best of finishes by Azmoun. If Syria do give the ball away, then they can be picked off.
The winner of this match will meet Japan in the quarter-final. A Japan team who beats Bahrain by 3-1. A Japan who maybe have started to grow into this competition after some unevenness in their performances.
That's excellent defending. Halil Sadeh not letting Umar Herbin get the ball so he can turn and run at you.
Awais combatively attacking as he likes to do, move forward from right back and play a role in the build-up of goal-scoring chances. Not that there have been a huge number, and we've got a potential head injury here.
Yeah, Hessar jumped into his man a little bit there. I do think there's going to be a lot of physicality in this contest. Getting up very quickly is Soja. I'm not injured, I'm not hurt. That's old-school centre-back work. That's fair enough from Hessop. And the earlier move, the lovely little diagonal ball in. It's narrow, isn't it? Oasis is very, very close to keeping him onside. And Azmoun with, as you say, it's a phenomenal international record, 50-77.
Back on is Shoja Khalilzadeh. He's from Mazandaran province, right up in the north of Iran, in the Caspian Sea area. His family with a connection, actually, when one looks at the traditional industries of Qatar. They are agricultural and work in fishing. So much of Qatar's early history was dominated by fishing and the pearl trade. And when he goes back home to Mazandaran province, he is an absolute celebrity there, the talk of the town, Shoja Khalilzadeh. Now plays for Traktor, one of the big clubs in Iran. Out wide is Mehdi Taremi.
Usul was so strong there, just holding off Mehdi Gherdi.
Ezatolehi. 15 is Rozbeh Cheshmi of Esteghlal, another of the mighty clubs in the Persian Gulf Pro League. And fierce defending, as it's going to have to be throughout this whole match.
But that's good football, getting Ramin Rezaian around the outside. The fullbacks are going to have a role to play. Get to the byline, get behind Syria, and then you've got good strikers like Azmoun and Taremi to come on and try to meet the ball. Set players could also be a good, useful source for Iran. Centre-backs are both up for this one.
Shoja Halilzadeh scored against Palestine. He was well positioned from a free kick. And the goalkeeper made a bold move and got sufficient connection. But once again, it is Iran in possession with Ramin Rezaian. Just put a little too much on that, looking for the creative Alireza Jahanbakhsh.
Those driven balls to the near post from that last corner, enticing the goalkeeper to come out. He did get a touch onto it, but there clearly wasn't a call because the centre-half in front of him took it away from him. Nonetheless, no damage done. Syria have got through the opening 10 minutes. Little incremental. They'll want to get through 20 and then 30. 10-minute little sections of the game.
They had to work so hard against India. No doubt that's a foul by Awais. As I was saying, they had to work so hard against India to eventually get the goal. Omar Khabin producing the moment which took them through to the knockout stage of the competition for the first time ever.
You can see that the grass has been watered. Awais sliding in, getting a very, very tight rein.
Jahanbakhsh comes off Amar Ramadan, who's going to need to track back an awful lot in this match. And he's a player who, at his best, is wonderful from wide positions in the attack. But he will really have to cover the full extent of the field of play. Play goes on with some calls for a free kick there, but it's all immaterial as drifts across the goal rather harmlessly.
Well, that's a lovely ball across the face of the goal. And if Azmoun or Taremi are gambling, you put a ball across the six-yard box, you've got every right to expect your centre-forwards, and they serve them, to try and get a touch.
Captain Haji Safi now has to deal with that loss of possession. A midfielder and a centre-back in charge of the teams today. Appropriately enough, the centre-back in charge of a team which is really dominated by its defensive efficiency. Hector Couper did have a few appearances for the Argentinian national team back in 1984.
And he'll be happy with how his team have defended so far. There's just that one little scare when they allowed Iran to get round the back. Jahanbakhsh trying to get forward. They do push bodies forward, do Iran, and you can get at them, because they do expose their two centre-backs, and so Syria will be just looking to break the trap.
Haji Safi of AEK Athens in Greece, and he plays today for the 141st time for Team Melli. Izzat Alehi tried to spot Mehdi Taremi, but Taremi wasn't really making a run through. That is a free kick and a yellow card.
And that's really good play, first by Essar and then by Herbin. They're not going to see a lot of the ball, and they've made life very difficult there for firstly Ruzbey and then Shoje. And the yellow card puts him out of the next round if Iran were to get through. I do apologise. No, it doesn't.
But he is in trouble now for the rest of the game, and that's going to be a very, very long wait to see if Syria can put him under enough pressure to draw a second yellow card. As Syria do have three players on yellow cards. One of them is Omar Khubin, the captain. Also, Abdulrahman Awais at right back. And Mahmoud Al-Iswad, wearing number 25. Good play, this, from Syria. Here is Ramadan, first chance, really, to see him in an attacking position. And Shoja gets a touch, but not the most compelling of touches. A couple of Iranian players almost bumping into each other. Khubin is not fouled, play goes on, Awais has it. Number 21, Ibrahim Hissa, one of the Argentine connection that you were talking about earlier, Des, for Belgrano. And he was part of their promotion campaign last season, mostly used as a substitute, but an important substitute as they went up to the top flight. And it is quite a fight to get out of the Argentine second division.
It is. There may be a lot of teams at the top flight, but yes, getting into it is very difficult. And Hisar's put himself about, made life very difficult. In Syria, having got through the opening 15 minutes, I think are beginning to say, OK, yes, we are the equal, we can take Iran on, and we could get a first win in 50 years.
Touchback from Haji Safi to one of the strongest goalkeepers in the tournament, Alireza Behrenvand. Nicely done. Taremi tried to flick it towards Azmoun.
Well, it's gone out for a goal kick, but that stem from Behrenvand's distribution, that is one of the real assets of Behrenvand, who's back with Persepolis at the moment, but was in Europe for a long time. And he's arguably, I would put him down as the best goalkeeper in Asia. He's commanding, he's a good shot stopper. And his distribution from foot or from the throw, he can throw the ball 70 metres.
Haji Safi. Taremi. And didn't quite get the communication right there, the Iranians.
But Taremi is finding that little gap in between the two central midfielders and the two centre-backs. He hasn't put a good pass in yet, but it is just a matter of time.
Well-placed header there from Al-Iswad. Went to Khubin, who keeps the attacking potential alive, but only for a moment or two. Yeah, he's got really quick footwork as Mehdi Gayedi.
Combative, utterly combative. Even though that clearly hasn't gone out, everybody is appealing, starting with the coach, Hector Cooper. Bim, he needs to be careful. You don't want to lose him for the next round if they go through.
Gayedi. Well, at the moment, serious preparation evidently has been extremely focused and tidy, because they understand the Iranian build-up play. They're in the right place at the right time defensively, and they've done what others over the last little while, not just in this competition but in the matches leading up to it, have really struggled to do, which is to contain the Islamic Republic of Iran up front.
Good patient build-up from Iran. They can't just push the ball forward. That's what they need to do. Get Taremi onto the ball in those little spaces. And Hodos has got an important role just to prompt.
And here he is, Saman Hodos. Now he's going to test Mohammed Al-Ajan, but he passes the test. He is from Damascus, the oldest capital city in the world. Settled extraordinarily in the 3rd millennium BC. And he plays for Al-Jaish in Damascus, the first Syrian club ever to win the AFC Cup. That was in 2004. Exploring his options is Alireza Jahanbakhsh of Feyenoord in the Dutch top flight. 23, Amin Rezaian back to Jahanbakhsh, and behind for a corner kick to the frustration of Ammar Ramadan, who wanted to prevent that because they know how dangerous the Islamic Republic of Iran are from corner kicks.
But better concede the corner than get Jahanbakhsh in behind you to the byline. But 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 white shirts all attacking the penalty spot area.
One of them is Said Ezatollahi, who at one time was the youngest ever goal scorer for the Iranian national team. He's now 27, but he was only just 19 when he scored against Turkmenistan in November of 2015. It isn't the record anymore. Just around about the halfway point of the first half, a big opportunity for Iran.
Again, it's well defended. They're getting to the second ball, they're competing for the first ball, and they're making sure it's a red shirt that is there for the second.
Kodus. Oh, he's been brought down and looks like he's been hurt. I think there's too much doubt that a yellow card had to follow that. And that is a problematic one for Mahmoud Al-Eswad, because he has a yellow card from earlier on in the competition.
He'll accept it if his team go through, but now they've got some defending to do. Hodos, quick feet. That's a sore one as well, right on the metatarsal.
The free kick will come in from Ramin Rezaian. Oh, close to really troubling the goalkeeper, and once again, well defended. We are sounding somewhat broken record-like here, Des, but Syria have been very strong defensively so far. That said, here is Gayedi, and the goalkeeper deals with it comfortably. Good stop from Medania.
He's landed awkwardly there, because it just skipped up off the floor from Gayedi. Didn't quite catch it right, Gayedi, but as you can see, it just skips, and it's an awkward one. His bottom arm fully extended just lands right on it. He'll be okay, I think, but when you put your full weight on the shoulder, that's how I got my dislocation many, many years ago. Hurts.
I nearly dislocated my shoulder overfilling my breakfast plate this morning.
It's a good clean strike. It's a good save. Of course, the keeper has got to make the save. Gayadi got a couple of goals already, likes to try to shoot from distance. There is a fair amount of concern over him.
Well, the options in reserve for Hector Couper, should it be necessary, are Ibrahim Alma, who has played 84 times for the national team, and Taha Moussa, who's played just 6 times, so one imagines it would be Ibrahim Alma called into action if necessary. He is now back on his feet, Medania, and all is looking okay. But just a moment there of anxiety, I think, on the substitutes bench or among the coaching staff. Another corner kick. And from the edge of the area, the goalkeeper has made a very good save. A couple of saves. I think he had to gather it the second time. And it was the captain, Haji Safi.
Yeah, his reaction in actually catching the ball after it had come through a ruck of players. So he got his body behind it. But then so important was to make the second catch. It's a very good save, that. Haji Safi, he's only scored 7 in 140 games. But this one is onside, and it's the best moment that we've had. Nice clean volley. Acrobatics. Good camera.
From the perspective of the Kasyun Eagles, it's been a really, really good start to the match. They haven't been comprehensively unpicked at any point defensively by Iran. They haven't managed to enormously challenge them up front, but that is, one imagines, an ancillary concern. It's just about getting through as much of this game as possible in a disciplined fashion, and they're doing it. But here is Alireza Jahanbakhsh, who quickly sends the ball in, and it's thumped clear safely by Khalil Elias, who's just become a marquee signing at Johor Darul Tazim in Malaysia. This is going to be Gayedis to bring under control, but dashing back and winning it back. Yet another example of just how hard Syria are working. It was Al-Aswad on that occasion. Oh. A brilliant block.
Al-Aswad doing fabulous work then. Uso's made 4 immense defensive header clearances already. The pressure is on, but he's been a standout defender this whole tournament. And Syria, as we've seen, they've only scored the one goal, but they've only conceded the one as well.
Taremi to Gayedi. An overlap is coming, should he wish for it, from Haji Safi. Instead plays it in to Taremi. A little touch behind, or it's going to stay in play, actually. Well, that was more promising from Iran in terms of how they got around the Syrian defence. And that's going to be a foul on Hisar.
Hisar on Soje, on the back of him, and he's had a yellow card. You said he's got to be careful. Yes, he wants to be very, very tight. There's going to be a talking to here. Referee Kim Jong-hyuk, as we have a look at the other effort, Azmoun doesn't make a gamble for the 6-yard line. He wants it pulled back to him, which is almost impossible for Taremi.
And then after that, the foul on Hisar, one imagines that Shoja Khalilzadeh is rather close to the line right now, and a lot of the game still to be played.
And they've got not a lot of cover at centre-back. Indeed, Rusbet alongside him started the first game of this tournament in central midfield. He got a suspension and an injury. So they are down to the bare bones at centre-back.
Shepherded behind by Ayam Uso. When you look at the group that Syria were actually in, It's an extremely difficult group. They did fantastically to get out of it. In terms of the FIFA rankings, it was, pound for pound, the trickiest group out there to become a third-place team in. The separation between the teams in terms of the FIFA rankings, not that great.
And they suffered some key injuries as well to key players. So he has been effectively building a team at this tournament, Hector Cooper.
There's Atolehi. Only ever actually played for one club in Iran, Malavan, for a two-year period. Oh, that's a penalty kick, it has to be. What an unfortunate moment for Syria, because after such defensive discipline throughout this match, Ayamuso has fouled Mehdi Taremi and made it very easy for Kim Jong-hyuk to make a decision, despite Syria firmly protesting.
There is no doubt. It's an unnecessary challenge. Taremi is going nowhere. And Uso, who's been outstanding so far, comes across and just barges him in the back. There really is no reason to do that for Uso. Overly aggressive, Taremi, even if he gets the ball, he's facing away from goal. And however upset he is, Uso, he'll look back on that and his coach will look back on that penalty every time.
It will be Saman Hodous to take the penalty kick. We've seen this gentleman be agile and athletic so far. Now he's going to really need that. Omar Khubin offering his guidance. Oh, is that going to be a change, actually? It looked for a moment like it was going to be Hodous. Now it is Mehdi Taremi. So there's been a consultation, and the outcome is that Taremi will take this penalty kick.
I think Taremi was always the man to take it. Hodous was just making sure he could just focus on the penalty. Taremi, big chance, of course.
He scored twice against the United Arab Emirates. He has 44 goals for the national team. Excellent penalty kick. Mehdi Taremi, after all of the defensive resilience from Syria, gives the Islamic Republic of Iran the lead. It is 1-0. And his team has finally found a way through, and really, they were gifted that by Syria.
Yeah, Uso was impetuous. Really didn't need to be so aggressive into the challenge. It is a clear barge, and Taremi to the injured Maharami. They say, this is for you. Mehdi Taremi sends the keeper the wrong way. It's a good confident free kick. Eyes on the goalkeeper. Waits for him to make a move. And that changes the complexion of how Syria have to approach this game.
Goal number 45 for Team Melli, for Mehdi Taremi, the Porto player. It's interesting, he's been struggling in his league football this season, only 3 goals in 15 appearances. 22 goals in 33 last season. 20 goals in 32 the year before. So this has been an anomalous year for Mehdi Taremi, but it hasn't translated to his national team form, where he's continued to be extremely effective. Scored against Burkina Faso in one of the warm-up matches.
It's easy to say who he hasn't scored against. So, Syria, what kind of response are we going to get? We've got Hector Cooper just in front of us. in our commentary position. No changes, I wouldn't imagine, for a while. You don't want to open yourselves up to the Islamic Republic of Iran.
If you are watching this, supporting Syria, the Kassioun Eagles, you may wish to put your hands over your ears while I say this next bit. Syria have only scored in one of their last 10 matches against the Islamic Republic of Iran. That was a 2-2 draw in September of 2017. Over the last four matches, the record is Iran 12, Syria 0. But Hector Couper has proven, and his players have proven, that new ground is there to be made and new targets are there to be met and surpassed all the time, because Syria, after all, have for the first occasion in six AFC Asian Cups made it out of the group stage. So his players have shown themselves to be disrespectful of the form book, and good thing too.
It's a good Islamic Republic side, though. They look strong defensively, although Shoje is, of course, on the yellow card. So they need to be careful. And they've had so much of the ball.
Hodous goes out wide. Finds the goal scorer, Mehdi Taremi. There is an absolute authority about the way this Iran team plays. They're capable of holding the ball very well, but they are also able to produce goals of elegance and style. They have a power to how they defend, and they have a lightness of touch and a delicacy to their attack at times. They are a very compelling team, and if they get to the quarter-final and they face Japan, it will be a really intriguing contest.
It is a big if, though. Still best part of an hour when we had time on at the end of both halves. Omar Herbin lost his shin pad, has been told to put it back on.
Always. Flick was from Elias, goes to Herbin. There's an overlap here. Instead, the shot was too tempting a prospect for Mohamed Al-Ajan, who has scored once in his previous 69 games.
Moves a bit in the air. Berenban just has to watch it carefully and make sure it doesn't bounce off him. As I said, though, a very, very good goalkeeper. And how about that for a throw, pinpointing to Taremi.
Certainly, Mohamed Al-Ajan would have been one of the strong candidates for most unlikely goal scorer in the match, having found the net against Afghanistan in 2015. And that's it for the Kassioun Eagles. And if you are wondering why they are called the Kassioun Eagles, it's a mountain, Kassioun, overlooking the ancient city of Damascus. A word that possibly means hard and dry in the Syriac language. Two words also used to describe the defensive qualities of Hector Couper's team.
Absolutely, that was nearly a poor pass in by Taremi, but they can build out.
Gayedi furthest forward on the left. Instead, Jahan Bakhsh goes through the centre, and he was tracked the whole time by Elias.
Elias has made a couple of big stops, flying into the challenge when he's sensing that Azmoun on this occasion is going to put a shot in, but it's just another corner.
Once again, players like Shoja Khalilzadeh, wearing number four, forward. Rusper Çeşmi, wearing 15, is also there on the edge of the area. Said Ezatolehi in the centre. And it is Shoja. And the goalkeeper has been impeded in the judgment of Kim Jong-hyuk.
Yeah, he's tried to come over the top here of Mehdi Taremi. Taremi's just stood in his way. Yeah, one of those where, of course, the goalkeeper will get the free kick. But centre-forwards all over the world are probably saying, never, never a free kick. I think Hector Cooper would be on the pitch if he possibly could be. He's that into the team. He's brought that much energy and organisation, constantly drilling his team from the side.
And he'd still find a way to get not one crease in that suit of his. The man is sartorial and impassioned on the sidelines as ever. And what he's done, the ground that has been broken by their passage to the knockout stage, has captured the attention of the footballing world. Now, a little space here. Not easy for Gayedi to control it, and he's got a waist back, trying to restrict his chance to get the ball in, which he's done successfully.
Oasis had a brilliant tournament, but he's got work to do again.
Gayedi goes past Oasis. Taremi, comfortable.
Nice idea, just trying to shade it around the centre-back, Kruma. Who's been solid, comfortable for goalkeeper, Madanye.
It's been uneventful for Alireza Behrenwand. Alireza Jahanbakhsh to his captain, Ehsan Hajisafi.
You wonder what it'll take to take Iran to the next level. They always do so well in qualifying for World Cups, but never getting out of the groups. And even in the Asian Cup, they haven't won this year. I'll break off just for a moment.
Sada Azmoun benefiting from that tricky bouncing ball. Is he going to shoot? It looked as though he was about to and then decided to pass to Taremi. And relief for Syria if they were caught out by an unpleasant bounce. But the danger goes on. And overhit.
Well, pass selection has let Islamic Republic of Iran down then. There was space, he got the better of Kruma, who made a rare error.
We are approaching additional time. You're watching the round of 16 at the AFC Asian Cup Qatar 2023. Iran in the white against Syria for a place in the quarterfinal and a meeting with Japan. That is something for Behrenwand to do. And it will be a tricky second half for Iran on the evidence of the first half. But they have managed, courtesy of that penalty kick from Mehdi Taremi, to get the breakthrough as we reach five additional minutes on the board. Now, Hisar. Played on by Ezekiel Alam, and just too much power for an anguished Mohammed Alajan.
We saw the amount of water on the surface earlier on, and that ball just skidded away. If it was a bit drier, that ball would have stayed up, and it would have been a lovely 1-2 between Alam and Alajan. As you say, it'll be tricky the second half for Islamic Republic of Iran, but nothing they'll be worried about. They'll think if Syria do come at them, they will have the chances to exploit any space.
Flick from Ousu. And here is Mahmoud Al-Aswad. Just his fourth appearance for the national team. He's only 20, one of the bright prospects identified by Hector Couper. That's the second time that poor old Mohamed Al-Ajan has not been able to keep a ball in play because he's been given nothing to work with.
It's a nice idea from Issar to try and play it out to him, but Al-Ajan had come inside and that ball went over his head. Although they've had three wins out of three, Islamic Republic Iran haven't been on fire. Hong Kong made them work very, very hard for that 1-0. The UAE game ended 2-1, although it should have been a lot more.
Ramadan to Omar Khabin. Yes, it really was in the first game against Palestine where they displayed their finest football so far, as we see Mehdi Taremi's comfortable penalty kick. And a tribute to the injured members of the squad.
They may miss the presence of those injured players should they make progress. Two defenders, it is going to get tougher if they get through. Japan await. That will be the test of any defensive resources.
Gayedi, very well done, and he's going to win the free kick.
US is getting a final talking to. That's three times. One time it was given as a simulation by Gayedi, but there's been two fouls by US, and that will be the last one. That's been an intriguing battle down the right-hand side of the Syrian defence.
A decent spell from Syria where they've enjoyed a little possession in the Iranian half. They're back under some pressure. Izatolehi, Jahanbakhsh. And all the way back now to Alireza Behrenvand with just over a minute to play in this first half. Brilliantly done by Al-Aswad. Can Syria gain an unlikely equalising goal with this last opportunity? No, they cannot, because Alam didn't quite get the angle right looking for Owais.
Again, it was a nice idea. The execution wasn't perfect.
But there's a little more impetus to the way Syria are playing now. The pass before the pass has been the one that has been their undoing on a few occasions. Meanwhile, Taremi. He goes down and the referee stares and shakes his head and trots away.
Again, to the naked eye, it looks a very, very good call. Taremi has stayed down on the floor. Syria are coming forward.
To the displeasure of the Iranian fans. Al-Aswad, the goalkeeper. Oh, I was about to say the goalkeeper has no issues with it, but he very nearly did. But it's all for naught, ultimately.
He's got that under control. Two hands behind it, drops it into the chest. Not exactly the technique you'd want, but Behrenvand. Nice, safe, secure goalkeeper, and Iran end up with the ball and with a lead, courtesy that man, Mehdi Taremi.
His third goal of the AFC Asian Cup, Qatar 2023, a 34th minute penalty kick from Mehdi Taremi, his 45th goal for the national team. Lots of discipline from Syria, lots of determination, lots of hard work. That was always guaranteed. Unfortunately, a moment of lapse in concentration from Ayam also defensively, and all of that meaning that Syria are chasing the game.
They are indeed. Usu had been outstanding in just about everything he'd done. And then it's not exactly a rush of blood to the head, it's just over-aggressiveness on the back of Taremi in a position where he didn't need to be overly aggressive. It is an easy penalty decision, and it's been well dispatched by Mahdi Taremi. Islamic Republic of Iran deserve the lead, there's no two ways about that, but 1-0 is a very tentative lead to have, and Syria are not out of this one.
And we'll find out in just a short while if they can mount a comeback. At half-time, Iran 1, Syria 0.
Continental Tires.
Of course, we're already doing business in Manila.
It's big. Global game changer.
They're creating new regulations for business.
Here we come, some of the world's brightest minds,
right? Precisely.
With enhanced activity to go on.
As soon as you're breaking up.
Can you sit him up? Can you start going up?
في أمور ما يغيرها الزمن، مثل أول بطولة آسيوية استضافتها قطر سنة 88. صحيح إن كل شيء تغير بعدها، إلا شيء واحد هو اللي كمل وياها، لمة العين. لمتنا مثل الأول ما تغيرت. الأسرع عندنا هي أغلى فوز ممكن نحققه. بمناسبة كأس آسيا، أصرت أغير ولا تغير.
The second half of this meeting between Iran and Syria at the AFC Asian Cup Qatar 2023. It is the round of 16, and that gentleman, Ahmad Medania, has only been beaten once. A penalty kick from Mehdi Taremi, an excellently taken penalty kick. We've seen glimpses here and there of what Syria can be, but Iran have made it very difficult for them to be anything other than defensive. They're going to have to change it at some point in this second half.
They're going to do it with the, or they're going to try to do it with the same personnel. It's the same 11. There's not an awful lot they can change. Big Sabak perhaps can come on up front to add a little bit more muscle to the front too. But I'm not expecting too many changes until around about 70, 75 minutes. Syria don't want to go 2-0 down. That's as important to them as trying to get an equaliser.
We start the second half. The Islamic Republic of Iran won Syria nil. Syria in possession. And they did enjoy a little spell of possession towards the end of the first half in additional time, but without an enormous number of clear chances to show for it. That said, Iran have not had huge opportunities themselves, but they had a huge amount of the ball, 74%. In the first half, and one goal from Mehdi Taremi from the penalty spot.
It was a deserved lead.
Hisar did well to cross from that position. That's going to be a foul, though. Clattered into Ehsan Hagi Safi.
It's a wonderfully brave header, this, from Hagi Safi. He knows he is going to get clobbered. Coming in at the far post, Hagi Safi. He's got to make this header, otherwise it's a clear header on goal, and he's incredibly brave. Lovely stood up ball, and it's the back of the head from Al Aswad, who doesn't really go for it. Hagi Safi, luckily it's the back of the head rather than the front, and so both players will be out for the count for a little while. But incredibly good defender. You can see exactly why he's 140 caps.
He did so well, Ibrahim Hisar, to actually get a cross in from that position.
And they do have a good front too. Herbin, we know, the number seven, just in shot there. And Hisar is growing into the game, and they can create something. So Hector Cooper, I'd be surprised if he changes too much, if anything, until about 75 minutes, and then it's a case of, OK, if we lose, we're out, so we've got to go for a goal.
It is extraordinary, as we look at the Iranian fans, to reflect upon the fact they've only won this tournament three times, and all of them back-to-back in 1968, 1972, 1976. It's not to demean being three times champions of Asia, by the way, but simply that it has not happened for such a long period of time. They didn't qualify until 1968. They then dominated the first few editions. They have been third on a few occasions, including in Qatar in 1988. It's their 15th time in the tournament proper. This is fixture number 72 for Iran, and they're on course for victory number 45.
And this group seemed fairly cohesive. No, very cohesive. Amir Ghanoui, the coach, he's just steadied the ship. He's not very histrionic down on the bench. The players seem to trust him. They know he knows Iranian football inside out. He's not somebody who's coming in and trying to discover what Persian football is all about. There is the man involved. It's a youthful looking 60.
Awais for the throw. He'll do the same again. Good to see Ehsan Hadji Safi looking okay after that brief injury delay. Was a clever flick on from Taremi to Gayedi, tracking back well. Aya Musso, and he's got to get back into position quickly.
Did well again, other than the aberration for the penalty. He has been really very, very solid, arguably the best defender for the whole tournament. And that says something, because Syria have defended extraordinarily well.
They've only scored one goal, Syria, but they've only conceded two. I mean, they've been an exceptionally difficult team to break down. Herbin, the scorer of that solitary goal, and well taken it was too, against India. It's going to be stopped for a use of the hand by Ibrahim Issa. He does not agree.
It's never Ibrahim Issa's fault, is it, ever? Which is exactly what you want, but if that's Ali Reba Behran, that's a good save.
Yes, the replay is somewhat on the damning side there for Ibrahim Issa. Clever touch again from Taremi. And he's offering an option. Just a question of whether they can get past Awais. Gayedi could not get beyond Abdulrahman Awais.
That's been one of the pivotal battles, and Awais is in there once again. He's had a really good tournament, based in Greece, got more work to do.
Hadji Safi, quick ball in. It falls to Amar Ramadan. I've mentioned it in previous matches, but I think it's a wonderful story that he's playing in this AFC Asian Cup in Qatar after his father played in the competition, Munaf, in 1988. And he was a very, very fine player, Amar Ramadan's dad. Scored in the Under-20 World Cup in 1991 against Uruguay, and also in a draw with England. Playing in that England team, the goalkeeper that he put it past, Ian Walker, went on to play many, many times for Tottenham Hotspur and quite a few times for the England team at senior level. Now, Jahan Baksh has Azmoun, finds Azmoun, the goalkeeper saves, will it go in? No, blocked at the near post by Uso, helping out his goalkeeper, who did half of the job.
Two brilliant pieces of defensive work there. Ripped apart, but Syria don't give this one up. A hint of an offside. Azmoun just stays onside. Excellent touch by the keeper, and then Uso back doing what every good centre-back should do. It's off the arm, but I'm sure VAR will have a little look at that and dismiss it instantaneously.
Position to take the corner kick is Ramin Rezaian, and the header has somehow not gone in. Abdulrahman Awais was by the post and did the job.
It hasn't gone in. It's a fabulous piece of defensive work. He just steps back into the position and off the top of that bald head, perfect. Shaved head, I should say.
Well, it was a close shave for Syria there. And they're checking to see whether there's a possible penalty kick meanwhile. But that's been completed. So it will be Ramin Rezaian once more.
There's a lot of tugging and hustling going on. It really is tough out there. Big men attacking the ball. And if Rezaian can just lift it 7-8 yards out.
Rezaian's ball is another useful one on the edge of the area, and an opportunity that has passed by quickly from Saman Hodous.
Syria have done well to attack the first ball, get the first touch, and then they close down Hodous to rather rush his shot.
That was very bold and too bold from Awais. Might be another defensive error that is the undoing of Syria in what has been, for the most part, exceptional work at the back. Rezaian, I mean, that would have been cruel on Awais after all that he has done fantastically if he'd been undone by that.
Indeed, it's their two brightest defenders, their two sharpest defenders in the tournament who've made the mistakes. Nuto for the penalty. Awais gets away with one there. There's a man down over on the far side for Syria. He might be forced to make a change on the bench. Well, they do have options, but not too many attacking options. He's only used, 14 players in the whole tournament so far. And Pablo Sabag.
Yes, he is one of the new arrivals to the national team, made his competitive debut against Uzbekistan, and an indication being made very clearly that Mahmoud Al-Eswad is going to have to be taken off. So we'll see now Pablo Sabag, who plays in South America. He's on loan at Alianza Lima in Peru from his parent club in Colombia, La Equidad, waiting for his time to come on as Syria are numerically disadvantaged. And they'll just want to get this ball away and make the substitution. Sabag is itching to come on. Not going to get the opportunity for the moment.
When it does come on, it might change the way they play. Either Gerbin or Hissar is going to have to play a more defensive role as a direct replacement on the right-hand side for Al-Aswad. Those possession stats still well in favour of the Iranians.
Want to get this ball out of play soon, Syria, to make the change, because they're in a little trouble. Jahan Baksh, oh, excellent play. Taremi unable to beat Medania, whose reading of that build-up play was excellent.
He gave Taremi nowhere to aim for. It's a lovely ball in by Jahan Baksh. Medania is out very, very quickly. Good goalkeeping.
Amar Ramadan. Is it back to Payer Kruma, who wears number 13. Awais. It's a real wait here for Pablo Sabag to come on. He's warmed up, cooled down, warmed up again a couple of times.
Meanwhile, in the meantime, down to 10 men. Now they'll have a chance to bring him on. And who will drop over to the right-hand side is an interesting one. I suspect Asa.
So, several minutes going by with Mahmoud Al-Eswad having to depart and the wait for Pablo Sabag to come on. Here he is. He's 26 from Barranquilla in Colombia. Another of the players with Syrian ancestry. He plays at the moment in Peru for Alianza Lima. His parent club is La Equidad in the Colombian League. He's also had loan spells at Newell's Old Boys in Argentina and Estudiantes. He was very good last season for Alianza Lima. 9 goals in 21 games. So he is a player who has proven himself domestically. He's adapted well to the national team, scored against Malaysia in the closed-door friendly match on the 8th of January.
He's a big unit as well. He'll add a certain amount of physicality. Not that there's a shortage of physicality out there.
Alajan. Khubin. And he's looking for the substitute, Sabak. And Sabak does extremely well. Now, what's the decision going to be?
Flag is up for offside. But an interesting one here. If it's not offside, there's a possibility that there's a penalty.
Well, immediate impact for Pablo Sabak.
You know what? He's not offside. You look at the back foot. Then when he gets there, he gets through. And even though the ball's gone, Berenbande is there, but the flag was up for offside, and that's what they cannot reverse. So that is an interesting one. VAR not allowed to intervene in that circumstance. Checking possible penalty. So if it is onside, we saw this actually earlier on in the tournament in a game involving Malaysia, but it was when the offside was given. So is he offside? That's number one. I don't think he is. You look at the back foot of the centre-back, then he lifts it over. There's definite contact, and this is a big moment. Pablo Sabak. The longer they check, the first thing they'll look at is that offside. Is it offside? Was that the correct decision? The whistle hadn't blown, and so the ball was still in play.
Now, there's been an instruction given from Kim Hee-gon in the studio in front of the monitors to Kim Jong-kyok to go across to the monitor pitch side, and that tends to be a very positive result. Based on empirical evidence of these video reviews, this is quite the angle, isn't it?
So they've clearly decided that the onside, he is onside. And now we're into this decision on the penalty, and that looks nailed on. Even though the ball's gone anywhere else on the pitch. In fact, that is a nailed on penalty any time of the day.
He continues to scrutinise the monitor. Kim Jong-kyok, his decision has been reached. The Syrian fans stare and they wait to see confirmation of the penalty kick. Pablo Sabag, the substitute, has come on and instantly won a penalty. And an opportunity for Hector Coupe's team to completely, against the run of this entire match, equalise.
Yellow card also for Berenbande for the foul. As soon as the offside was confirmed to be an incorrect decision over on the far side, this was always going to be the case. Sabak just got there ahead of Berenbande, who came out feet first. Doesn't matter that the ball is going wide, it is a clear foul. And a really bad one as well. VAR has got that one 100% correct.
The kick taker, Omar Khubin, who scored against India in open play, now looks to get just the second goal for the Kasyun Eagles at the AFC Asian Cup Qatar 2023.
The substitutions first, though, Ollie. That's what the delay is. Little bit of mind games. Double substitution before the penalty is taken.
Well, this is remarkable. So Mehdi Gayedi is one of the players departing. We're seeing Mohamed Mohebi come on, along with Omid Ebrahimi. We'll talk more about them in just a moment because they are side attractions right now. It is Omar Khubin who has to put all of that out of his mind.
Oh.
on this from Omar Khabin. Syria have drawn level when they have had virtually no chance to do so. But efficiency is the name of the game here for Hector Cuper's team. It's Iran 1, Syria 1, and the substitute has changed everything.
Celebrations and giving thanks. It's Khabin with the goal. His second of the tournament. That shows that it is onside. The man who's keeping on is Rusbeck. It's tight, but it's correct. And then, as you say, the coolest. He's looking at Behrenband, remembering Behrenband had already made one penalty save and just rolls it the other side of the keeper. Football, Ollie, football.
The substitute, Pablo Sabag. The determining factor in this complete turnaround of the match, because the moment that Omar Khabin put that ball down, you expected him to score, and if you're a Syria fan, you were not disappointed. Now, confirmation of the yellow card given to Alireza Behrenband for the challenge in the first place, but the real impact of that substitution proving that Hector Cuper knew exactly what he was doing when he brought on Pablo Sabag.
Tactically, the change is that Issar has come to the left of midfield. Amar Ramadan has moved over to the right. Khabin is now up front with Pablo Sabag. And Sabag was the one who got through on goal. Sabag likes to lead the line, and that gives Khabin a chance just to be a little bit more of a playmaker. And he's such a good player, he's more than capable of doing that.
After only scoring in one of the last 10 games against Iran, Syria have found the back of the net. The goal scorer, that's not a surprise. But considering what we saw in the first half, this has got to be considered one of the most surprising changes in tempo that we've seen in a match so far in this round of 16, and there's some pretty stiff competition for that. This is now where Syria have got to remain defensively absolutely focused. Good effort, that. Saeed Ezatollahi.
Always rising, catches it well. And I think the goalkeeper knows that that is always going over the top. Just a word on the semi-automated offside technology. It really does work. It solves any dispute. You now know that he was onside when the penalty, and the penalty was an automatic one. Really good technology and good use of the technology.
Will this prompt a response from Iran? Jahan Bakhsh to Taremi. Misdirected by Rezaian. The noise level in the stands from the Syrian supporters has increased so much since that penalty kick was put in, and they were pretty noisy to begin with. It's a remarkable atmosphere here. 10,000 capacity, and it's very full.
It's a proper football atmosphere.
It's already bonus territory for Syria to be where they are in this competition. But this, a draw as things stand against Iran, it's virtually fairy tale over the top of Taremi.
He's still the main danger man, Taremi. He's getting into really good positions, found a little bit of space at the far post then.
Jahan Bakhsh, and the goalkeeper holds that well because Haji Safi was close to him.
He's made a couple of good stops, which you expect him to make the stop, but so important that he holds on to it. This bounces off even a touch, and there's white shirts waiting to pounce. had a good game. It's had a good tournament. Was it 50 years since Syria beat Iran?
The 15th of May 1973 in World Cup qualification, Abdulhani Tatish scored in the 12th minute for a 1-0 victory. There have been 11 draws as well, but 18 of the 30 previous meetings have been won by the Islamic Republic of Iran. It's been a wonderful tournament, a tournament of so many surprise results. If Syria turn this match on its head and pick up a victory, it will sit up there with all of those surprises and maybe be the biggest of them all. A long way to go, and no sign of a change in the match as the goalkeeper claims tremendously well. It's Iran back in control again though, Des.
Yeah, it's confident goalkeeping that, but yes, Iran have had so much more of the ball. They're asking the questions, but on the breakaway.
He's energised the attack, Pablo Sabag. He's a very high-impact player. He makes decisions quickly, and he's somebody who can really aggravate defences. And when you have a player like Shoja Khalilzadeh, who's been shown a yellow card already, the presence of Sabag could be quite unpleasant.
The performance of Syria is a real vote of confidence for heritage players, and the involvement they've had in the Asian Cup and how it's equalising standards.
Cut out by Uso, and a foul. That's going to be a yellow card. Saeed Ezatolehi off the ball.
Senor Sabag making sure that everyone knew exactly that he had been knocked over. A scrap between two players, both arms are up. Game of football, I don't think at half time we really expected. We were discussing, and many people around us were saying, oh, Iran probably go on to take control of this. But what remarkable spirit Hector Cooper has put into his new charges.
Moon. Out wide it goes to Mohebi. Mohebi gets away from our waist, but that is another yellow card, and they're starting to become more common now. And there's Khalil Elias down.
Again, he's made so many little interceptions or blocks that far out. It's a lack of control. Trying to recuperate. This might, if we have a look at the replay, this might be interesting because he looks a little bit out of control. And in modern interpretation, there could be a problem here. We haven't seen a video replay of it yet, but if you're leaving a player that hurt.
Substitute Mohamed Mohebi is the player booked.
The foot's down. I'd be surprised if there's anything there. He's clearly going for the ball, and the trajectory of the studs is downwards. It's aggressive.
If things were looking strong for them before, it's all changed because of the arrival of Pablo Sabag. And should Iran lose their composure here and lose a player, then Syria could well be into a position of real advantage. Ali Holizadeh is replacing Ali Reza Jahanbakhsh.
Interesting one. He's had a good game. Jahanbakhsh, he's set up a couple of opportunities. Hasn't really got wide. Hasn't really got crosses in from the byline, which I think is the way you've got to play to try to get around Syria.
Player coming on, Ali Holizadeh. As we look at the player caution, Mohamed Mohebi. Holizadeh, 27, plays for Lech Poznan in Poland. He's from Ardabil in the northwest of Iran, a part of the country where Azerbaijani is actually the main language.
Iran continuing to press, Iran continuing to have more of the ball, and they're looking to win it in 90 minutes, but very aware that Syria have got this potency. Kerbin just behind Sabak. They are a danger.
Çeşmi. Substitute, Omid Ebrahimi actually plays in Qatar for Al Shamal. Another of the players, though, from Mazandaran province, right up in the north of Iran on the beautiful Caspian Sea coast, a very historic region of Iran. Won back really well by Taremi, who's looking very lively. He's got the ball, and the whistle has gone for a use of the hand.
By Taremi. He thought for a moment that it had gone his way. His reaction was one of excitement. Lovely, tight little play, it's off the arm. Azmoun and Taremi are trying to just work that little 5 or 6 yard pass. So nearly it's come off three times. But so nearly doesn't count.
Very pleased with that, gentleman, was Thayer Krumah, applauding the vision of Kim Jong-hyuk. We're now in the closing stages of normal time. We may be going further than that at the Abdullah bin Khalifa Stadium in Doha. His penalty kick, so well taken. Goal number 23 for the Kasyun Eagles. The first Syrian ever to be Asian Footballer of the Year. Three times a winner of the Saudi Pro League with Al Hilal. He's well travelled, he's decorated, and he's calm under pressure, Omar Khubin. But he's part of this new crop, Pablo Sabag, and his impact was instant.
Absolutely. Khubin, though, in that near World Cup year, he was almost unplayable. Thoroughly deserved Asian Player of the Year. He's still quality now, just lost a little bit of the extraordinary pace he had, but he's got the power, got the know-how. Syria still very, very much in this game.
And it's been a joy, hasn't it, to see him back in goal-scoring form in his domestic football. 9 goals in 11 matches for Al Wahda in the league. Now, is the substitute going to get onto this? No, Awais says, stay Awais.
Awais, a contender for Team of the Tournament.
Ebrahimi on the diagonal to test number 21, Ibrahim Hissa. He has both Syrian and Lebanese heritage from his grandparents, Ibrahim Hissa. Substitute Holizadeh playing it to his fellow substitute Ebrahimi, and all rather scuffed by Azmoun. Unusual for a player like him.
What a lovely little dummy this is, just in front. Taremi, so clever, knew that Azmoun was right behind him. Creates the space. Uso is chasing. That's a chance.
Especially when it falls to somebody who scored 50 in 75 games for the national team.
Bubbling atmosphere, bubbling everywhere. It's great.
And it's great to have your company as well, wherever you're watching from today, whoever you're supporting at the AFC Asian Cup Qatar 2023. Thank you so much for being part of all of the action and enjoying this flagship international tournament in the continent of Asia, a part of the world that hosts 60% of the planet's population and some of the most exciting football on earth. Can Syria shock Asia and indeed shock the footballing world? At the moment, there's no sign that that goal was anything other than an interruption, but it's a very effective interruption.
And having done it once, they'll believe that they can create another clear opening. Islamic Republic of Iran, oh, this is clever.
Ali Holizadeh. Taremi back onto Holizadeh. Oh, a good save from Medania. Clever football, though, and it goes on. Taremi, brilliantly positioned, he goes down and the decision has gone against him. He's been given a yellow card for simulation.
Second time Taremi has gone down in the interpretation of Kim Jong-hyuk. Great decision. Taher Kruma pulls out, and that was another fine save from Adanya. But it's been Ali Holizadeh coming in has made a real difference. He's got twinkle toes, left footer playing on the right-hand side, and has gone into two really good positions. But they're holding on, Syria, they're holding on. Taremi again, the man involved. Lovely little give and go. He's such a clever player. He can play up top, he can be a target man, he can play these lovely little balls in, and he can dive like the aquatic champions that who are here in Doha at the moment as well.
Mohamed Al-Ajan is regrettably having to be assisted off the field of play, and preparing to make an appearance is Fahed Yusuf. And the change is actually to remove Amar Ramadan to bring on Fahed Yusuf. Very, very experienced midfielder. He's 36, plays for Al-Shorta in Iraq. He is twice a winner of the Iraqi Premier League. He's played about 100 times for his club. He's also played in Jordan for several years and played for Al Saila in Qatar for a season in 2018-2019.
They were just making sure Al-Ajam wasn't having to come off the left back.
Iran still creating most of the chances, still holding the ball, but no longer holding the lead. No test for Ahmad Medania, whose display has been brilliant. Now we are getting closer to seeing Fahed Yusuf, who's desperate to get on.
Well, Al-Ajan is back on the pitch now. They were down to 10 men when that header came in from Azmoun.
That's the second time in this match that Syria have had a period of more than just a few seconds with only 10 players. It's quite some considerable time they're having to endure here. And it's that tricky Ali Holizadeh who's got the ball. And now the chance will be serious to make the change, and that's frustrated Mohamed Mohebi, because Iran knew they were in a numerical advantage. So now we'll see him at last, the veteran, for appearance number 44 for the Kasyun Eagles. Again, the change is yet to be made. Looks as though there's going to be a second change coming here for Syria. Alam puts it out, and now Hector Couper is instructing he wants to make that change. I don't think the referee was aware of that. It was very quickly put back in play.
Iran just want this tempo to be high. They don't want Syria to slow the game down in any way, shape or form. Let those substitutes cool down.
Always get some help from Ouso. It's going to be Ala al-Din al-Dali, an attacker who comes on as well with Youssef. Holizadeh. Holding it well is Mohebi. He goes back to the captain, Haji Safi. Mohebi looking for a crossing chance.
Being very patient they have. They're not just throwing the ball in because there's so many red shirts in there. They're just trying to manoeuvre a little bit of space. And if Holizadeh gets on it, he's probably the best option to do that at the moment.
Ezatollahi. That's a clever ball from Ezatollahi. Almost found Ramin Rezaian, but what a good piece of vision from Iran's number six. Now we will see the departure of Amar Ramadan. And also coming off is goal scorer Omar Khubin. So Khubin will be replaced by Ala al-Din al-Dali, wearing number 9, who has scored a couple of times for the national team and played for Qatar Sports Club in the 2018-2019 season. He's now at Naftimisan in Iraq, as is Fahed Youssef, or not at Naftimisan, but he's in Iraq for Al-Shorta. There is a very experienced player, 44 appearances now for the national team.
The shape will remain the same for Syria. Hector Cooper won't change anything. Herbin's done a good job, got the goal. And he's just getting the thanks of Hector Cooper now.
Well, we've already had one substitute change a game. Are we going to have another? Ala al-Din al-Dali is from Hama on the Orontes River in the west of Syria, famous for its giant water mills that date back to 1100 BC, and he's hoping to freshen up the game in the way that those water mills freshened up the gardens of Hama in ancient times. And he wouldn't be the first substitute to completely transform a match at the AFC Asian Cup.
He nearly got away there, nearly. That's produced this corner for Syria. Iran got some serious defending to do.
Elias with Thayer Krumah forward. This would be utterly sensational if they can make use of that corner kick, and that will remain a hypothesis.
Utterly sensational, completely overhitting. Everybody was looking to attack the front post area. 12 bodies in a very congested space, but the ball was hit way, way too hard. Well, there have been some shocks in this Asian Cup already. The Tajikistan story we'll be talking about has been talked about all over the world. Syria are looking to add another narrative.
And now it becomes for Iran, who were expected to win this match and probably win it quite well, a hugely nerve-wracking occasion. The pressure ratchets up as every second ticks by, as we go closer to extra time with a penalty competition, a possibility. This has been everything that the Iranian fans hoped it would not be from Syria.
Iran have done well enough and created enough openings, I feel, to not be scared of extra time. They'll be scared of conceding now, because that would leave them no time. But they'll believe in the extra 30 minutes. They've got enough quality on the ball. They've got enough impudence.
Olizadeh is providing the lion's share of that impudence at the moment, moving around quite freely in the midfield. Now, how much time will be added on? We shall find that out from the fourth official any moment now. Might be quite a sizable amount, as that's very well intercepted by Uso, who's driving forwards. And we are going to have 10 minutes more to play. Here is Al-Din Al-Dali, and it is a yellow card.
This is Taremi, this is a red. This is a red, they are down to 10 men. Taremi knew as soon as it made that challenge what a mistake it made. He was there covering a second yellow, the first for simulation and the second for denying Allah going through.
Well, he can barely bring himself to get to his feet, but he's going to have to and walk the walk that he did not want to.
He knows there at that moment exactly what he's done, and he's just hoping.
We said earlier in this match that Iran, who'd picked up a few yellow cards as the tempestuousness was increasing, would absolutely put themselves into chaos if they had a player sent off. That was before the Syrian equaliser. So it had already gone bad. Now it's gone from bad to worse. Great opportunity for Syria to win this match in the next 8 minutes. And it changes, even if they don't, the dynamic of extra time completely.
Syria will have to change how they play over the last three and a half, well, four games that we've seen, because we haven't seen them attack. And suddenly players whose first thought has been to be compact and tight might need to think, OK, how do I get forward? How do I get crosses in? How do we create some space? Iran, I'm pretty sure, will drop into a 4-4-1 defending.
Mirzayan now will drift back into position. Omid Ibrahimi.
Making predictions in this Asian Cup is a fool's choice.
That back pass was a risky choice. But they're okay. And we have around 7 minutes to play. Possibly a little more because of the red card given to Mehdi Taremi. But what an important touch that was as well from Ruzbeh Çeşmi coming forwards to cut out the long ball.
He is a centre-back, Ruzbeh. Normally plays in the centre midfield, but has to play centre-back. He's been rock steady.
Khalil Zadeh, who himself is on a yellow card. There's Ezatollahi, who's been shown a yellow as well. For Iran, it's a nerve-jangling time. The flag is up.
Azmoun offside. Just a little bit slow in coming back.
Can you imagine if Syria, who had never made the knockout stage before this tournament, beat the three-time champions and a team that many thought could win this whole thing? Sabah was nearly there after Al Dahli was also nearly there.
Behrman carefully clearing. Iran, I think, now are playing for extra time. Just try to reorganise themselves. But they've made change of personnel. They have. They will have the extra substitution that they can make.
Suddenly there's time and space for Syria. Awais's cross. The goalkeeper hasn't quite got his hands on it. He saw, and then Al Dahli can't finish. Blocked. Is this the moment? Not quite. Hisa and cut out. Syria pressing and pressing. And Iran throwing everything they possibly can at this ball to defend it.
Behrman didn't collect the first cross, which he really needed to do. He made a good save from the second, and then it was a case of desperate defending. Anywhere will do from Iran. You want Behrman to collect that. He's a better goalkeeper than that, but pressure force the error.
A penalty is being scrutinised, a possibility of it, by Kim Hee-gon, and that moment has gone behind for a corner kick. Oh, look at the fans of the Kasyun Eagles. My goodness. Some of them taking their phones out to preserve this atmosphere. Whatever you film of it, it won't do it justice. We're here in the stadium and it is extraordinary. Mohammed Al-Ajan with a corner kick as they press for the winner, the team in red. Back in it comes again, it's Uso.
Islamic Republic of Iran need leadership from their defenders and their key player, Behrman. To see him flap at that cross earlier on. Really wanted him to be stronger than that. And Syria have proven that they can change the game plan. They don't just have to sit back, but they are taking the game to these short-handed Iranians.
We're going to see a yellow card to Ibrahim Hisa. And we're also going to see a substitution made as Sardar Azmoun is replaced by Karim Ansarifed, who plays for Omonia on the beautiful island of Cyprus, but has played in Qatar. And he's got a real opportunity to steady things. That's if he gets near the ball, because Awais was trying to bring that beyond Haji Safi. And Syria were pressing for a dramatic win in the last moments.
Haji Safi was cool as you like there. Awais was just trying to invite some kind of contact on the edge of the penalty area. Energy of a man 30 years younger. Behind him, the technical staff are trying to encourage the crowd to get going.
Karim Ansarifed scored the first goal for Iran at the AFC Asian Cup Qatar 2023. Has he come on to play in the final moments of their competition? Syria are getting closer and closer to a clear chance.
Iran have got to show the same organisation that Syria have. And they'll be OK with Syria trying to play the glory ball, the 60-yard ball. As you can see, Hector Cooper is saying, let's just keep it simple, pass the ball across the field, don't ping it 60 metres.
Fewer than 60 seconds remain in normal time as Kim Jong-kyok strongly advises Hector Cooper to sit down, and I think a yellow card is going to be shown to the coaching staff.
That's because he was urging the crowd to get so involved, he inadvertently threw a water bottle onto the pitch. Didn't mean to. But there's the excitement. It's a yellow. Fourth official, eagle-eyed.
This will surely be the last opportunity for either team, if indeed there is one. What a brilliant display it's been from Syria in this second half, and how the game has transformed around a few pivotal moments. The first was the introduction of Sabag, but the red card to Mehdi Taremi has been another of them. Alajan opts for the lateral ball, and the attack peters out, and we are close to the end of the 90 minutes.
The animation, he has been like that for the last 10 minutes. He has been kicking every football. Anytime a pass has gone astray, head held in hands.
He's been like that for the last 50 years.
You introduced this game earlier on as the history that Syria have to overcome. Well, they are creating history of their own, no matter what happens.
Polizadeh, as we go well beyond the 10 minutes, there's been quite a lot of disruption in the time allocated for disruptions. Ali Polizadeh holds the ball, and we see who holds their nerve, because this game is moving into 30 additional minutes. And you know what? Good thing too, because it's cracking entertainment here. It's such a tense match. The Islamic Republic of Iran won, Syria won, two penalty kicks, but a red card to Mehdi Taremi perhaps gives the Kassian Eagles the advantage moving into extra time. We'll find out if that's the case.
Really compelling game of football. Another compelling game of football. Iran have been largely responsible for their own downfall. The penalty given away by Alireza Behrambaan, but it was good play by Sabag to get himself into position, and a correct VAR call before the penalty was awarded, put away superbly by Kherbin. But then that red card, and of all the players, Taremi, who plays in Porto, such a responsible part of the Iranian setup, for him to take two yellows in fairly quick succession for simulation and then for a near rugby tackle. Well, it does change everything. Good teams, though, Ollie, good teams, and we think Iran are good teams. They do find a way.
Absolutely enthralling second half it's been. Falling contest at full stop. Iran with Alireza Jahanbakhsh to Sardar Azmoun. Blocked by the goalkeeper, blocked by Ayam Uso. Ahmed Medania having a fantastic game. But the introduction of Pablo Sabag was what transformed this match. Alireza Behrambaan with a wild intervention Initially, offside was the verdict. It was then overruled on video review. Excellent use of video review. No doubt that it was onside. And there was also no doubt about the composure of the penalty taker. And no doubt about the lack of composure of Alireza Behrenband. So Kim Jong-kyok pointed to the penalty spot. And Omar Khabib was the coolest man in the Abdullah bin Khalifa Stadium in Doha, getting goal number 23 for the national team. Then it seemed that normal service was resumed. There was hope for Mehdi Taremi that he'd won a penalty kick. He'd actually won a yellow card, that's all. A crucial yellow card, because more was to come. This impetuous, impulsive challenge, seeing Iran reduced to 10 players. Mehdi Taremi, the goal scorer, now the man sent off. Devastation for Mehdi Taremi, opportunity for Syria. Into extra time we go.
Those highlights didn't really show the really crucial part Madania in goal has played for Syria. Made a couple of fine stops. Well, stops you'd expect him to make, but holding on to the ball, then he bounced off him and Iran would have had the chance, and also the work of Uso with that clearance on the line. There's been some really good defensive work, and now they've got to change their mentality on from not losing a game to going on and actually winning the game and taking it to Iran. The reduction down to 10 men, it might change the way Iran think about this. Yes, they'll still want to win, but more likely they don't want to concede. Language. Diaspora coming together, and Syria writing the new history. You spoke about it, you set it up perfectly. Is it a new dawn, a new opportunity for Syria? And for Iran, 16 match unbeaten run doesn't count for anything, does it? Should do, but it doesn't.
It is the joy of the AFC Asian Cup. So many surprise results. Every unwanted record is there to be overturned. Every narrative from the past, in terms of the losses you've had, the disappointments you've endured, is there to be rewritten.
Japan await the victors of this, rather like the epic last night that we had between Saudi Arabia and Korea Republic. Australia were the main winners of that one, because such fatigue will kick in. Japan will be saying, hope this one goes into extra time and added time into extra time and taken into tomorrow. And I wouldn't be too unhappy if that was the case. This has been compelling, compulsive stuff.
We await the resumption of the Abdullah bin Khalifa Stadium. The first half of extra time. 30 minutes more to enjoy, or to look at it another way, 30 minutes more to endure if you are some of these players, and if you are fans of Iran and Syria, finding this a very anxious viewing experience. One imagines that it is the supporters of Team Melli, the three-time champions of Asia, who are the more nervous ones now. Iran reduced to 10 after Mehdi Taremi's second yellow card, and the foul from that gentleman, Alireza Behrenband, had earlier given Omar Khabib the chance to equalise from the penalty spot. All of that's taken us to where we are now. Where we're going in the next 30 minutes, goodness only knows.
They'll try and play with three up front when they're going forward, Iran. That's the introduction of Ansaris Fahd. He'll play as an out-and-out main striker. Two wingers will get up in support. 4-4-1 when defending.
Khalil Elias moves it to Oase. Goes back to Elias. And it's clear the fans of Johor in Malaysia are getting more and more and more excited by seeing this chap arrive in their team.
Well, I know he can defend.
Yes, that's right. His previous club was San Lorenzo in Argentina. He was born in Rosario in the northeast of the country in Santa Fe province. Oase positions himself for the cross. It's cleared. The danger continues. The substitute, Aldin Aldali, with the shot.
Very ambitious, that one. He was under immense pressure from Rusbe Chesney. Teams look full of spirit, and fitness doesn't seem to be an issue just yet.
Substitute and Salifert to fellow substitute Holizade, just behind and Salifert was always ambitious to try through from that position from Elias. As a result, Iran have it back with Rezaian. And this is where a fatigued player can administer a late challenge, gift a needless free kick, also can misplace a pass.
Rezaian stopped. Now, it wasn't such a bad ball, but Rezaian thought that he was just going to edge into offside, so he checked his stride. And it makes it look like a bad ball by Alec Alizadeh. Still think Alizadeh's got an important role to play in this match. He's looked very tricky.
Mohamed Alajan. Now it's with Ousso. All of the Syrian players now seeing so much more of the ball at their feet. More time.
Until they get 40 yards out, and then Iran closed the door. So the questions Iran were asking of Syria about how could they break them down, it's a role reversal. The position of Oase, the number 24, he's been defending for the last four matches, and now he's being asked to play almost as a right winger.
And those of you who watched the match between Syria and India will have had the chance to see a little more of Oase in an attacking role. And he is very good at doing it. He's good at coming forward.
Set of supporters really giving it something.
Another cross that doesn't quite find the mark, to the frustration of the players in the area. But my goodness, he must be so proud of what he's seen from these players at this competition.
And he'll want to take it on to the next stage. Yusuf coming in, he's a left-footer playing on the right-hand side. He'll always step back inside. That's why Oase is so important. It gives them the option to try to get the ball in when they are attacking Syria. Iran looking very composed, though, in possession, not hurrying.
Sam felt he was obstructed by Hisar. As we have a look at Thayer Krumah, who's had a busy day and a busy tournament.
Hisar's on a yellow. And he was blocked off. And it was with intent.
The one advantage that Syria have at the moment is that red card to Mehdi Taremi. It's the one thing that's giving them a little time to use the ball. The last thing they need is to concede a needless red card themselves. Flicked back by Hisar. Alajan playing it to Krumah. Rousseau. Alam. Back to Alajan, as there is no clear path through to goal being presented to these Syrian players. None whatsoever.
Yeah, Iran are doing a very good job in keeping the ball in front of them. West over on the far side. He's trying to edge forward. That maybe is one of the routes.
Alam finds Alajan. He's forced to come back inside. They're just giving them nothing in terms of space, the Iranians. You said earlier, Des, after the red card, that Iran needed to be as organised as Syria were, and they have demonstrated just that.
It's very impressive, actually. Very impressive the way they've operated. Of course, it could all still go wrong.
Alajan opts to play it from deeper that time, understandably so, considering that no chances were forthcoming closer to goal. Krumah driving forwards to our ways. He's got a chance to get this in.
Superb defending on the back post. Rezan, who's very good coming forward that time, he just made sure that Hisar wasn't going to get a free header. But they released a waste down the right-hand side. Not the best ball in. But that's the way you feel that Syria have got to get around the outside of Iran.
And here they go again, once more to try to build something. Quickly play, different sort of build-up from Owais to Sabag. Brought away some much earlier that time, and the decision goes the direction of Syria, to the frustration of Iranian fans and players.
Shoji's going to get a talking to here, because his reaction, well, you can see that he thinks he's being held and that there was a pullback, but his reaction was one that could, if he's not on a yellow card, have warranted another yellow card. Really good refereeing. Really good. The referee's assessor might not agree.
Oh, was there a pull there by Shoja Halilzadeh?
Sabag is looking for that. He's leaning into the centre-back.
It's further evidence, though, isn't it, of how he has made things feel very different in attack for Syria since coming on, Pablo Sabag. He's provided that clear target for them.
It's gone out of play. It's a throw-in for the Islamic Republic of Iran. There's not many clear chances being created, but this is utterly, utterly absorbing. The movement off the ball that Syria trying to just create a little bit of space. And was a cacophony of noise as a backdrop. Tight little stadium, drums beating.
Ehsan Haji Safi, the captain of Iran. And it was clearly indicated, wasn't it, by Mohebi, what to do. They were in cahoots and they forced Owais to put it behind for a corner.
That shaven head doing the job once again. Remember, he saved one off the line earlier on. That was in early in the second half when a second goal would have really put Iran in the driver's seat.
Now they have a chance from this corner kick as we enter the last few minutes of the first half of extra time. Punch clear. Ebrahimi opts for the pass to Ezatolahi. And very well played by Ayhan Musso. A strong leap to touch it away.
Musso was magnificent then. He had three white shirts. Behrenbahn takes a risk, but he's comfortable playing the ball like that.
The goalkeeper judges it really well, Medania. And what has been a performance of enormous quality from Ahmad Medania. Well, we still have as little clarity as at the start of this first period of extra time.
But we do know Syria are more than just a defensive team.
Musso, as expected, to Owais. Youssef wanted that ball played quickly to him. That's good intervention from Çeşmi. Just caught there, Ayhan Musso. Nothing could be done about it. The ball a little overhit.
Good play by Omid. He's won two tackles in the centre of the pitch. Just overhits it.
Khalil Elias receives it again. Owais makes the run on the right. He'll get it from Fahed Youssef. Youssef makes his run. That time, Owais was looking for him, having elected not to use him in the previous attack.
Shoje again attacking the ball, the two centre-backs. Rosbe and Shoje being very positive.
Musso. So much is down to the movement of Owais. You get the feeling if it is going to come, it'll be a ball provided by him. He just has to get the delivery to be of a higher quality at the moment, but he's getting into promising positions for Syria. And we'll discover if there's much time to be added on in this first period of extra time. Doesn't seem like it will be a great deal, and it is just one single minute. Mohamed Mohebi.
Sabak defending from the front.
They're both making life really very difficult for each other. This is so different from the extra time of the Saudi Arabia-Korea Republic game, which was full of chances. And Sabak has gone down near Rusbe Çeşmi, and the referee says, you've gone down, now get up. Aldali can go no further.
And the first signs of cramp we're seeing then, not surprising, it's come from Shoje Khalilzadeh.
And that is the end of the first period of extra time. Whistle blown by Kim Jong-kyok. And really, it has followed the pattern of the conclusion of the 90 minutes. Very tight, very little in the way of opportunities. Iran, despite their numerical disadvantage, stopping Syria having anything concrete to speak of, but they haven't managed to create much of their own.
Indeed, it's excellent defensive work, it's great organisation, it's centre-backs attacking the ball at both ends of the pitch. The penalties both had to be earned, but Iran down to 10 men, they've just been so well organised, and Shoje and Ruzbeh. Ruzbeh, remember, doesn't play centre-back that often. They've been really, really strong. Obviously, we think about penalties, but Syria will say, we want to win this in extra time. So will Iran, because it does become such a lottery. There's the sight. It's glorious. Such a tight little stadium, packed with so much emotion.
And there's such a sense of buoyancy among the Syrian players. You may have seen earlier some of the Iranian bench just shaking their heads. They almost can't believe they're in this position. A game that looked as though it was going to be theirs to comfortably see out. And they've been drawn into a very difficult match here with Syria. And we are seeing magnified the strengths of this Syrian team.
Substitutes available. There's three changes still allowed for Syria and a couple still left for Islamic Republic of Iran. You get the extra option in the if you go to extra time.
So much intensity coming from the coaching staff. Hector Couper walks away confident that the message has been administered. It's a team with belief, it's a team with purpose. It's a team that, having made it this far for the first time ever, is showing no desire to walk away now. They've tasted the knockout stage and they want to drink from the well.
Deep breath, and then we'll go again. Final 15 minutes.
It's the second half of extra time. Islamic Republic of Iran 1, Syria 1. Two penalty kicks. Firstly, Mehdi Taremi, more on him later. And then Omar Khurbin. But after that, the aforementioned Mr. Taremi given a second yellow card. The first was for an act of simulation. And it has evened this game up. It's a strange thing to say that removing a player for Iran has evened it up, but it has felt like that because Syria are getting the sort of time on the ball that Iran have been enjoying. All of that, though, has yet to translate in this period of extra time to real chances for either nation. The quarter-final is next, but it may come after a penalty competition. Japan will meet the nation that wins this after their own 3-1 triumph over Bahrain. A great Bahrain team who gave this tournament their very best shot, well plucked out of the air by Medania.
Of course it was, and it needed to as well, because coming in, looking almost for a simple little touch, was Ansarifad.
Also, whose work has been extremely impressive today, putting to one side his ill-advised challenge on Mehdi Taremi. He's been marvellous.
They're going down the left-hand side at the moment, but it is down this right-hand side where you've got the twin threat of Fahad Youssef and Owais. Owais on the ball. This is where the best moments have come since they had the man advantage.
By Nkrumah. A great idea that, to play it into Al-Dahli, who keeps it in but can't get it back to a teammate. That's very well won by Elias. Temptation to shoot instead. A beautiful pass, it might be offside. I think it is offside. Pablo Sabah could just straight ahead. But a great idea.
Somehow finding a little bit of space. Referee's come over to the dugout. This time he's come up to the Iranian dugout, and there's a yellow card being handed out. That one I didn't see.
Yellow cards everywhere, frankly, in this match.
Iran expected this to be very tough, they knew it. But I suspect it's even tougher than they thought it possibly could be, and they haven't helped themselves.
We go back to that record of just one win ever for Syria in 30 previous meetings against the Islamic Republic of Iran. Here is Ali Holizadeh, who has had a sense of vigour about him since coming on. Tries to get beyond Alajan, instead to the edge of the area. In the end, blocked, as has happened on so many occasions. Good play from Shoja Halilzadeh. Might have just tweaked his knee there as he landed.
I think it's just a little bit of cramp. At the other end, it was Yali Elias once again with another block on the edge of the penalty area. Three really important blocks, because you never know.
Out of play it goes off Ibrahim Hissa. Splendid, splendid atmosphere at the Abdullah bin Khalifa Stadium. Its capacity of 10,000. This might be the opportunity. No. What about ambitiously from range?
He's gone out for a throw-in. Uso with the header. Brilliantly done.
Well, in this part of Doha that is the home of the complex of internal security forces in Doha, the Duhail district, appropriately enough, the goal has been under lock and key for most of the match. Nonetheless, it has been an arresting game to watch. And in which direction will it go? What is your pick watching at home? Do your heart and head agree with each other?
Syria trying to take the initiative. The organisation once again from Iran. It may seem straightforward, but when the runs are made, the runner is being tracked and there's cover behind. Alam was looking for some movement, some kind of space.
This might be it. Sabak. That is brilliantly done by an obviously tired and struggling Shoja Halilzadeh. But the 34-year-old was very, very alert. He's now getting some help from his teammate, Ruzbeh Çeşmi, and he needs it too.
This is the third time he's gone down with cramp. He made the header before. You noted, you thought it tweaked a knee or something, but it was cramp. He went down for quite some time at the end of the first half of extra time. And now he's going away again. You never know. That's a physical advantage. Sabag is a big, strong man. He's only come on... Well, he's been on the pitch 45 minutes, maybe a bit longer. That might be something for Syria to try and go for. Go centrally. Look for the physical advantage. Sabag over. Khalil Sadeh.
Meanwhile, there was Karim Ansarifed, who scored the winning goal in the Cypriot Cup final last season for Ammonia Nicosia. Can he be the player that produces another late winning goal?
Terrific defending. Rusbet. Any player who plays centre-back for Esteghlal, they always seem to have this big physical presence about them. And Rusbet's had that.
Yes, he grew up in Tehran, did Rusbet Chashmi, but his family is from the rural northeast of Iran, right up by the border with Afghanistan. Now calls the Iranian capital home. Plays for one of those massive historic clubs in Esteghlal. The substitute, Mohammad Mohebi, who has scored four times for the national team, fancied his chances.
So much power on that, it's gone right to the very back of the stand behind the goal there. That takes some power, but it also means it's quite some way off target.
And in this very compact and rather pressure cooker-like stadium, one imagines that the toss of the coin to determine at which end the penalty kicks are going to be taken could be quite significant. The fans are very, very close to the goal. They make a lot of noise. You'd really, really want your own fans behind that goal in a place like this. But let's not count the chickens before they've hatched, because there's still over 5 minutes to go in extra time.
I'm sensing a goal, I'm sensing a mistake, I'm sensing this fatigue, certainly at the back for Iran.
The veteran substitute, Fahed Youssef, has had a positive impact since his arrival. Yes, I think that just about sums up everyone's mood.
The Taremi red card, or second yellow, really did change everything. Iran would have been fairly happy, I think, with extra time if it was 11 on 11. Now they're kind of hanging on. The West takes a knock. Little elbow into the ribcage. Top marks for referee Kim Jong-hyuk. Difficult one, this, and I think he's acquitted himself very well.
Kruma, as Syria have just a few minutes left to make their numerical advantage of players count on the scoreboard, or will he be happy for this to go to penalties? One imagines that for the Syrian fans, if you told them before the match this will go to penalties, that would have been good enough. Gosh, if you'd said to them at the start of the competition this is where you'll be in the round of 16. Just a goal kick.
There is a hand just around the front of the chest. Earlier on in the competition, the officiating seemed just a little bit stricter. And then he moves the hand away. I thought they were harsh penalties when they were given earlier on in the competition. A couple of minutes from the end of extra time in a knockout match would be especially harsh. But again, referee Top marks from this correspondent team.
Can Iran win it? They can't even hold the ball at the moment. Quick touch from Elias. Moved on equally quickly from Ezekiel Alam. Now it's with Alajan. Back to the Buenos Aires-born midfielder. That Argentine spine in the Syrian team as the Argentine manager dances around and almost does jumping jacks on the sidelines. He's telling Abdulrahman Owais exactly where he wants him to go. Youssef, and the whistle has gone.
You may say it was the shoulder. I think the television pictures, young fellow, will suggest you're inaccurate. Two minutes, Ollie. The way Baron Vand is taking a little bit of time here suggests that... maybe it was the shoulder. The way Baron Vando is taking his time, he fancies being a hero. He's saved one penalty already this tournament, don't forget.
There will be a substitution made by Iran. Mehdi Torabi, the player who arrives and substitute now is substituted, Ali Holizadeh. So Mehdi Torabi of Persepolis comes on with the penalty shootout quite probably in mind. He has scored seven times for the national team, Torabi. Actually has won the Persian Gulf Pro League on four occasions.
Good player.
We await to see how much time is added on as Al-Dali is going to chase this down, but he's offside anyway. And it seems now that penalties are impending.
Yeah, the last 5 minutes or so, both teams have been a little bit slow to get the ball back in play. They're kind of... accepting the inevitable and all the drama that that entails.
They will know who their best options are. Amir Khalinoi and Hector Couper. How that will translate into the delivery from the penalty spot is in the lap of the gods.
There's a little bit of wind in this arena, and that just seemed to catch on the wind, and it was a nervy moment for Madenya, because he's probably thinking penalties. He's had a terrific game. Baron Vand will fancy his chances of making at least one save.
Will we get there? A minute and a half to go first. Youssef brings it towards the halfway line. Elias. Kept in by Owais. Absolutely fantastic response from Syria. Owais with a chance that might be one of the last opportunities. He has to go to Elias. Elias floats one. It's now with Ezekiel Alam. And yet again, problems in the defence for Iran.
Jorge is on one leg. Cramp has utterly taken him.
This is hugely problematic because he just cannot... He can't move at the moment. It could be that their best chance is right now, Syria. If they get this in, will Jorge Halilzadeh even be able to lift himself off the ground to jump to clear it? At the moment, no chances forthcoming, but he's in dreadful difficulty, Shoja Halilzadeh.
great protection in front of him. They were trying to feed the ball into Sabak. Such awareness that was.
Out it goes. Will it come in? This might be the very last opportunity. Headed away by the Iranian defence. And that brings us to the conclusion of this round of 16 match, save for one important order of business, penalties. The Islamic Republic of Iran 1, Syria 1, 2 penalties already. We've got many more to come. Who will progress to the quarterfinal to face Japan? Which of these two goalkeepers will be the ones who write their name into footballing history in their countries? Yes, take a deep breath, take a wry smile. Take your pick. Who will it be that is victorious? We're going to discover as this one goes to the drama and excitement and many, many other hyperbolic words of a penalty competition at the Abdullah bin Khalifa Stadium in Doha in the round of 16 at the AFC Asian Cup Qatar 2023.
So who do you pick? They brought Tarabi on. I'd imagine he's one. It's down to the goalkeepers, though. Obviously, do they dive? Do they go? Who's going to be brave enough not to dive on one occasion? There have been so many penalties, and the penalties usually have to go straight down the middle. Two penalties have decided that this game goes into a penalty shootout. It's been absorbing, and of course, the best still to come.
Let's take a moment to remind ourselves of how we got to this stage with penalties impending. A really enthralling match it has been. The extra time period, cagey, full of few concrete chances. The introduction of Fahed Yousaf wearing the captain's armband has been important for Syria, bringing them a little stability and also a little creativity. Plucked out of the air by Ahmed Medania, who now gets ready to fling himself to the ground as the penalties come in towards him. There was just a brief opportunity, a couple of chances here and there for Iran, but all of it very speculative due to the discipline of Syria.
Is still getting treatment for cramp. He played. statistically, those going first do better. Didn't work last night, Saudi Korea.
The first penalty taker is one of the substitutes, Karim Ansarifed, who scored their first goal of the AFC Asian Cup Qatar 2023, 2 minutes into the game against Palestine. He takes on Ahmed Medania. Wonderful start. High quality penalty taking from Karim Ansarifed. 1-0 to Iran.
All business. Approaches it well, strikes it well, hits it right in the corner. Keep saying that's the perfect place to do. It needs something truly exceptional to prevent that going in. Advantage Iran.
The next player is one who created a penalty kick for Omar Khabib. Now he takes one himself, with Khabib no longer on the pitch. Pablo Sabag, the substitute who changed the dynamic of the match. Very well taken down the middle, daring the goalkeeper to remain in position.
Which goalkeeper's going to be brave enough to do it on one penalty? So many go down the middle. You stand up and that's an easy save.
Pablo Sabag, whose form has been so strong in club competition in South America. His job now is done. He watches and waits. Ramin Rezaian for Iran is the second taker. The 33-year-old is playing in his 62nd match for the national team. He's very experienced. He spent several years of his career in Qatar. He knows this stadium very well. This was his home stadium. Ramin Rezaian. It's another excellent penalty in much the same place for Iran, and they lead 2-1.
He's now the pride of Isfahan, is Ramin Rezaian. It is a long, long wait before he strikes the ball. And gave the impression that he was going to blast this, instead finds the corner.
The gentleman who took the captain's armband, Fahed Youssef, the 36-year-old who plays in Iraq, takes the next penalty for Syria, and Alireza Behrenvan makes a save that frankly is comfortable. He judged it well, and now the pressure is on the Kassian Eagles.
Behrenvan is such a big, tall man, and he stays pretty static. Fahad never really looked comfortable coming up. He can't go left foot or right foot, but that's not the best penalty. Nerves getting the better of an experienced player. And Syria have got nothing to lose here, nothing to fear. They've already surpassed expectations.
Omid Ibrahimi, who plays in Qatar for Al Shamal. Very experienced player. He has fired that in to the roof of the net. It's a wonderful penalty kick. Three splendid penalties.
There's a hand here. There is a hand for Medania. He gets ever so close to a wonder save. Oh, it's off the top of the fingertips and into the top of the net, but too much power.
Another defender steps forward. Ayam Uso. He's a young player. It's just his fourth appearance for for the national team. It's a huge pressure penalty kick, this. And it's a wonderful penalty kick. Oh, well done, Aya Musso. It would have been so easy for the young man to crack under the pressure, and he did not yield.
Very often when you're under the biggest pressure, you put the ball the way that you're most comfortable. You don't want to open your body, you want to hook it into the corner. That's what Usu does.
Still, though, it is advantage to the Islamic Republic of Iran.
The Bee Gees would approve.
Taking this penalty kick, Mehdi Torabi, who came on as a substitute right before the end of the match, clearly, specifically for this purpose. And he has also delivered penalty taking of the highest caliber. This is marvellous from Iran, marvellous.
All four have gone in the same kind of area, into the crease of the net with great power. Again, if Madania even goes the right way, it's exactly where the previous penalty went.
And now Alaa Al-Din Al-Dahli has the job that nobody wishes to have to step up and do. He must score to continue Syria's journey. And that is brilliant, considering the weight of the occasion. That might be the finest of all of them. Well done to him.
Well, Syria have expected, surpassed expectations. That is a really good penalty. Berenvan goes the right way. He knows that Alaa is going to blast that. And the veteran, Haji Safi, to earn a place in the quarterfinals. But Ahmed Madania is the one more, little bit of heroics from Madania.
Ehsan Haji Safi, the captain in his 141st appearance for the Iranian national team to win the match. That is a stunning set of penalties from Iran. Syria have been beaten, but they have not been defeated. This was an incredible tournament from the Kasyun Eagles. They've gone further than they have ever gone before. Their pride should be immeasurable. On this occasion, they were not quite able to defeat three-time champions of Asia, Iran, but there's no shame in that. There is no shame in that.
Terrific penalty. Again, you go the way, you hook it into the corner. That's a natural swerve of the body. Send the goalkeeper the wrong way in some style. That's what you want a veteran player to do. And that's exactly what he did. Good teams find a way to win. That is the message I'm getting from this from Iran. They've somehow come through, despite being down to 10 men. But come through, Ollie, they have.
In this setting of the Abdullah bin Khalifa Stadium in Doha, a place designed to remind the world and to remind the people of Qatar, of the Bedouin heritage of this nation. The Bedouins, who commemorated their own identity, preserved their past with epic poems that live on to this very day. Well, it is Iran who will be singing into the night. It is Iran who will now journey to another place. It is Iran who will journey to the quarterfinal.
But we must give the last word to Syria. Congratulations on coming through a really, really tough group. Congratulations on pushing Iran all the way. Well done on that journey. Well done to Hector Cooper for finding so many new players from the diaspora. They go out, but they go out with pride. And Iran, well, is that long wait over to retain this cup?
It finishes Iran 1, Syria 1. with Iran victorious after penalties. They go through to the quarter-final.